main reasons for the aggressiveness with which COVID-19 has struck the world. Number 1, high contagiousness of SARS-CoV-2. Number 2, high morbidity. And number 3, lack of specific therapies. Well, if you're confused about these terms, watch our video on epidemiology. This last factor, in particular, has forced governments all over the world to adapt non-pharmacological containment measures, such as school closures, social distancing, and self-isolation of those infected, as they are the only feasible measures to flatten the curve. To date, May 26, the day that we're recording this video, there aren't neither vaccines, the most effective form of primary prevention for infectious diseases, nor drugs that can heal us from infection. Yet, doctors can do a lot to help SARS-CoV-2 patients. Although we can't stop it, its mortality rate can be reduced through supportive therapies that, by relieving symptoms, give the body's immune system time to produce an effective response to the viral infection. The main support therapies are oxygen therapy, which is used to alleviate respiratory problems that may occur as a result of more or less severe lung damage due to SARS-CoV-2. Corticosteroids, used in particular to alleviate the serious systemic inflammatory picture created to fight the virus. Well, it may seem strange, but once stimulated for a long time, the immune system itself can become a source of damage to the body. It's just like in a war. As in a war, in fact, not only do soldiers die, but often it is the civilians who suffer the greatest losses. Having a powerful immunomodulatory action, corticosteroids monitor the inflammation in order to limit any potential damage to the body. Before administering these drugs, though, a cost-benefit analysis is essential. That's because limiting the immune response also means extending healing times. Moreover, corticosteroids are not free of side effects. Well, another support therapy is convalescent plasma, more precisely called hyperimmune plasma, or blood plasma transfusion of patients healed from COVID-19. Their blood contains specific antibodies against the virus created by the body during the course of the infection. Well, the goal now is to speed up the immune response times by providing SARS-CoV-2 specific antibodies from outside that they infect the patient with otherwise developed spontaneously in no less than a week. Although promising, the actual validity of this therapy is still under evaluation. Moreover, a major obstacle is the blood supply donated by convalescent patients, which limits its applicability on a large scale. And then we have antibiotics. Well, it seems a little counterintuitive to use antibacterial drugs in a viral infection, right? Well, not really. This is because very often, in conjunction with a viral infection, bacterial infections can also occur, mainly because of the amount of cells destroyed to allow the spread of the virus. Therefore, when there is a persistent viral pathological picture, antibiotics are given as a preventive measure to avoid further damage to the organism. While the fact that there is no specific treatment for COVID-19 does not mean that the research hasn't moved forward to find it. Well, in these months, researchers all over the world have been studying all kinds of therapeutic strategies that could, above all, act directly on the viral spread. While studies are undoubtedly based on the previous scientific literature on SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV, given the similarity with the new virus, but not only. In particular, the main therapeutic strategies under study are hydroxychloroquine, lopinavir and ritonavir, remdesivir, and tocilizumab. Hydroxychloroquine is a particular drug already used for the treatment of malaria and certain chronic inflammatory diseases, such as rheumatoid arthritis and systemic lupus erythematosus. Its therapeutic mechanism of action? Well, from the studies conducted, it seems that this drug blocks the virus from entering the host cell. In particular, this process seems to occur thanks to the inhibition of receptor glycosylation, thus preventing the recognition of the virus by the receptor of the host cell. As a result, the cell cannot proceed with viral endocytosis. And thanks to the inhibition of endosomal acidification, which results in lysosomes failing to destroy the phagosome containing the virus. In doing so, an accumulation of non-destructible endosomes will occur and induce an apoptotic death of the host cell to the detriment of the virus. In addition, by attenuating the production of pro-inflammatory cytokines and inhibiting lysosomal activity, this drug has an important immunomodulatory action. Well, thanks to its action, in fact, greater control of the systemic immune response, but, above all, of its collateral damage may be possible. Obviously, at present, there is no sufficient scientific evidence to define the treatment with hydroxychloroquine as the anti-COVID-19 treatment. But according to the results of the studies conducted so far, hydroxychloroquine may be a potential winning pharmacological approach in the fight against SARS-CoV-2. Lopinavir and ritonavir. A couple of drugs used in the past for the treatment of HIV, another dreaded virus. The rationale of their use is essentially the inhibition of certain viral proteases important in the reproductive mechanism of the virus for the formation of its proteins. In particular, these drugs prevent the action of three chemotrypsin simul protease. Although in theory, these drugs could be excellent candidates for the therapeutic treatment of COVID-19, at the moment, there are no scientific studies demonstrating their actual effectiveness against SARS-CoV-2. On the basis of the current scientific literature on the subject, we can still define their therapeutic role in such a viral framework as limited. But hopefully the results of our ongoing studies will surprise us. Now let's move on to remdesivir, definitely the drug that you heard the most about in the media. Well, this is a drug that is particularly effective against RNA viruses, and which has shown amazing results in the treatment of Ebola. Well, this drug acts directly on the replication of the genetic material of the virus, inhibiting the action of viral RNA polymerases called RDRP, RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. In particular, according to the studies conducted in vitro, this drug seems to inhibit NSP12 polymerase, which would allow its expansion within the body. At the moment, it is another potential candidate for the treatment of COVID-19, given its promising in vitro effectiveness against many coronaviruses. And then there's tocilizumab. Unlike the drugs seen so far, treatment with tocilizumab has no direct action against the virus or its replication mechanisms. It is a monoclonal antibody already used for rheumatoid arthritis, which blocks receptors for interleukin 6 present on the cell membrane. IL-6 is a cytokine, a small protein that mediates messages. Well, in this case, IL-6 is a very important messenger of inflammation. Therefore, tocilizumab has an inflammatory action, which, from the studies conducted so far, seems to result in a clinical improvement of the patient, as it appears to limit the complications caused by the systemic inflammatory picture. Therefore, it could be an excellent support therapy, perhaps if associated with a real antiviral treatment. Well, in addition, as demonstrated by a recent publication, the study of possible antibodies specific to the viral S spike protein is also being studied in depth. Well, an initial identification has been made, but further studies are definitely needed to develop a complete treatment with monoclonal antibody against the dreaded SARS-CoV-2 protein. Of course, the most effective long-term therapeutic strategy is undoubtedly the vaccine. A great deal of work is being done to develop an ad hoc vaccine for SARS-CoV-2 that will prevent the infection and avoid its spread on an international scale. Microbiologically and economically sustainable ways to cope with the rapid expansion of the disease are now under study, which go from classic vaccines with attenuated virus to the most innovative ones with viral mRNA. Doctors are struggling to minimize the damage of COVID-19 while waiting for an effective treatment or vaccine. And we can do our part. How? By giving them time. Time for what? Well, time for scientists and doctors around the world to develop and test new therapies. And the most powerful weapon we have is, as usual, one, prevention. So be safe, always better safe than sorry. Therefore, respecting the emergency protocols put in place by the different governments in agreement with the scientific community is not only and simply important, but also fundamental. Little and simple things make a big difference.